Attention. At this moment, you are now listening to
a Radio 1 show.
If you are offended by words like
poo, wee, bum,
ass, ho,
ias, ho, aurake, gun, sieve, dirty pants,
tramp,
yes, tramp, good one,
dirty, low, slut, tramp, bitch, ho,
oh, I think that's going a bit far,
whatever, take the tape out now. This is not a pop album. And by the way, suck my mother...
homemade toffee.
Fist of Fun.
Coming to you from the Pleasance Theatre, Edinburgh. Yeah!
Hello, I'm Stuart Lee. And I am called Richard Herring. And welcome to Lee and Herring's Fist of Fun.
Fist of Fun.
Yeah, that's right, Fist of Fun, a comedy show which, like most others, takes a broadly topical and wryly humorous look at what's going on in the crazy world around us each week, but with the original comedy twist of coming from the blinkered perspective of two emotionally stunted and slightly odd blokes in their 20s who live in separate but equally unpleasant rented accommodation in South London, have no proper jobs or interests, never read newspapers and watch a lot of daytime television, and therefore have no real idea of what's going on in the real world at all.
Did you like the beginning there, everyone? I sampled that myself from the opening of controversial hardcore Los Angeles gangster rapper Ice-T's excellent 1993 album Home Invasion as a tribute to Ice's anti-censorship stand. Although I did have to change it a bit because we're not allowed to swear on Radio 1. But thanks anyway, Ice, for sending your message to people like me.
I don't think that the music of Ice-T is really aimed at people like you, Rich. He is a lean, black freedom fighter from the riot-torn streets of the urban war that is South Central Los Angeles. And you're a fat, middle-class, white bloke from Cheddar in Somerset. In fact, correct me if I'm wrong, but your dad is a headmaster called Keith who owns a caravan.
Cheddar is a very violent place, Stu. Three mods from Western once ran amok up the gorge and threw a table at my friend Brian Bancroft in the Cantonese takeaway. My friends are the new unemployed underclass of Britain today.
Yeah, but that's because they still think that electricity is the magic of the Wookiee Hole witch.
Ha, ha, ha. Nowadays, in the Southwest, electricity only arouses suspicion, not fear.
Fun.
Absolutely marvellous fun.
Fist of Fun.
Anyway, Rich, we're doing this sort of topical show, so have you got anything in any way amusing to say about anything topical this week?
Well, Stu, we don't know, do we? Because although this is October now, this week's edition of Fist of Fun is being recorded at the Edinburgh Fringe Festival last August.
Yeah. That's clever of the BBC, isn't it, to make... make us record an anti-topical topical show 2 months in advance.
Stu, don't slag off the BBC live on Radio 1. Look what happened to Dave Lee Travis.
What, nothing at all ever interesting in his whole life ever?
Yeah, anyway, it's OK, Stu. I've got a clever plan. We can just do some jokes about Edinburgh and the Fringe and then pass this show off as some arty retrospective Edinburgh Festival special and no one will be any the wiser.
Well, all right, but this mustn't happen again.
Thought for the week. As Samuel Johnson said, when a man is tired of Edinburgh, he's probably visited the castle and the Scott Monument and is wishing he could go back to London where there is lots to do and at least it isn't really cold and rainy all of the time.
Yeah, anyway, it's good being here in Edinburgh, isn't it, Rich? It's good to get away from South London where we usually are all the time and get out of the house, you know. What have you been up to then? Been up to the castle or the Scottish National Gallery, have you?
No.
Been up Arthur's Seat, have you?
No.
Been to any of the 2,614 shows of new drama and comedy and dance that are on?
Not really, no. I've been staying in the flat most of the time, playing my Game Boy.
Right. So, just like in London, then?
No. I'm in a new country, Stu, and when I'm in a new country, I like to sample something of the local culture. So I went down to the Edinburgh Virgin Megastore and bought a new Game Boy game. So what have you been up to recently?
Well, during the last month, I've been worrying quite a lot about the financial, creative and social pressures of the Edinburgh Fringe Festival. And I've been unable to sleep because every time I close my eyes, I'm chased through a maze by giant disease-carrying rats with the faces of all the other stand-up comedians in Britain. And This reached a height last week, just before we came up here, when I went out most nights, driving round and round the Elephant and Castle roundabout in South London, saying, damn you all to hell! And then I was sort of pulled over by the police 5 times for no apparent reason at all.
I wonder what that could have been. I tell you what, why don't we go back over the incident, right, shall we? And I will ring this buzzer every time I think you've made a mistake with the policeman.
Okay, all right.
Do you mind stepping out of the car, please, sir? Is this your car, sir?
Yes.
You been drinking at all, sir?
No.
Do you take drugs, sir?
Yes, I do.
I'm going to have to stop you there, really. Can anybody spot the mistake that Stu may have made
there?
Anyone?
What did I do?
Well, is there anyone out here who would say yes if they were asked if they take drugs by a policeman? Anyone? See? No, not anyone, Stuart, apart from you. Why would that be?
I don't know, I just did...
Maybe, just maybe, you should have said no there. Mm. What would you think, officer?
I'd have preferred that, yeah, Rich.
Well, you know, but... Well, I do take drugs, don't I? I mean, just the occasional puff on a funny cigarette, admittedly. But I'm in my mid-20s, I've got an earring, a vaguely trendy haircut, a leather jacket, I work in the arts, and I drive a 1971 tan Morris Marina. I mean, of course I take drugs. It doesn't take a certificate from the Hendon Police Training College to work that out, does it?
The point is, Stu, you mustn't be honest with the police, right? It confuses them.
Right.
All right. Anyway, what happened next?
So you do take drugs, sir?
Well, sometimes, but I haven't got any on me at the moment, so you don't need to search me or anything.
What, Stu? What do you think's going to happen, like, if you say to a policeman that you take drugs, but he doesn't need to search you? What do you think's going to happen next?
Is it that the policeman will let me go?
Oh, zero.
Really, sir? I'm sorry, officer. No, he has to search you now, obviously, doesn't he? Okay. Well, carry on.
Some kind of comedian, are we, sir?
Yes, I am. That's very astute of you, officer. I'm a stand-up comedian. That is the kind of comedian that I am.
Now, Stu. Now you're being sarcastic to a policeman.
No, I was just saying what it is that he...
Even you, Stu, should know there's nothing that upsets the police more than sarcasm. Not even crime. Rodney King was sarcastic to the police, Stu. Look what happened to him.
Yeah, I'm going to have to go now, all right, gentlemen? I've got better things to do than spend all night intimidating ordinary citizens. Can't think what they are at the moment. The thing is, Stu, there's no such thing as objective right and wrong. The notion of what is crime is maintained by the overriding moral fashion of the day, and each of us simply fulfills the victim or oppressor role appointed to us on the day of our birth.
Right.
If only, Stu, if only the world could be as true and honest as you.
No, come on, officer, you'd never say that, would you?
Sorry, yeah. Get back in the bloody car and piss off, will you? We're in the police force, we don't expect the truth, and we don't like it.
Ow!
It's a fist.
And now, like on Anne and Nick's Good Morning, it's time for our first natural break. So please welcome, with some top recipe and lifestyle ideas, a Welsh man from Balham in South London, Peter Bainham.
Thank you very much. I'm Peter. I'm here with mainly some recipes, but also one or two other lifestyle ideas which I thought up with my brother Charlie. The recipes are all from a book which I recently tried to get published, which was sort of inspired by Delia Smith's One is Fun. Mine was called One is Quite Lonely, really. Delia Smith says, interestingly enough, in the introduction to her book, if you're the sort of person who enjoys pouring boiling water over instant gravy granules, then I'm afraid these recipes aren't for you. Well, I actually say the same in my book. I mean, don't worry about the boiling water. Just eat the gravy granules straight from the box, the way nature intended. Anyway, my first recipe is a simple, delicious snack for warm summer days. It's called Simple Summer Fries. The ingredients are one bag of frozen oven chips and a bowl, you see. Now, what you do is you open the bag, as I've done earlier. Then you pour the chips into the bowl, and then you eat them, like that. And that's especially delicious with a cigarette. There you go. Now, a brief warning before I go on. Not all of the ingredients in these recipes are that easy to get hold of. And some news agents don't even stock them. So before you do anything else, find yourself a good news agent, right? Now, your news agent, you see, and the relationship you cultivate with him is very, very important. I mean, I was in my news agents the other day, and I went over to the cheese display and I picked up a piece of mature cheddar, and I said, "Excuse me, how would you cook this?" And he said, "I don't know, and put it in a sandwich or something." And when I got home, I did. It was very nice. So try that when you get home tonight. Right, my final recipe for this section is what you do is you take a slice of mighty white bread, chew up some bread. Don't swallow it. Just try and get it into jowls. Like a hamster would. Next, you do the same with half a Mr. Kipling custard slice. And a tablespoonful of jam. Finally, take a swig from a bottle of sherry. And there you have it. Instant trifle. And that's a delightfully filling way to get drunk on your own. Anyway, I'll be back with some more recipes in a while. But in the meantime, here's another idea for dealing with another problem, which I'm sure a lot of people have, which is what to do if you just suddenly start crying in the middle of the street. Just pretend there's something in your eye. That's what I usually do. Or think of something happy, like a clown. See you in a bit. Thank you.
Done.
Thought for the week. Serious critics have proved that the high-profile presence of brewery-funded stand-up comedy at the Fringe Festival is killing experimental devised theatre. Oh, well.
This.
Yeah, we all like a drink, don't we, Rich? Yeah. And drink leads us naturally to the other thing that we've been thinking about a lot in Edinburgh, and that's sex. And there's nothing funny or rude about sex, so there's no reason why we shouldn't discuss it in an open and mature way.
Nice!
Ah, yes, there is a reason why we can't discuss it in a mature way. I remember it now, it's you.
Yes!
It?
Yes! I know all about sex, Stuart. Mm. And I saw a bear lady once.
Yes.
Well, I was hoping to meet someone up here in Edinburgh, Stu, because I haven't actually had a serious girlfriend for a year and a half now, for some reason.
Yeah, it's strange, Rich, isn't it? Because, like, mayflies, for example, have only 3 hours in between hatching and dying in which to find a mate, and they always succeed. So if a small, unpleasant fly can form a successful relationship in 180 minutes, you'd have thought you could have managed it in 25 years.
Ah, yes, but I, Stu, I'm more choosy than a fly, aren't I? I'd never try and get off with a fly, for a start. Well, not unless I was really drunk. Oh, well, OK, I did once get off with a fly at Christmas, but, you know, it was quite good, actually, because a gnat's chuff is literally as tight as a gnat's chuff.
Yeah, Rich, but the reason for that is because a gnat's chuff is literally a gnat's chuff, isn't it? You see, what you've done there is you have misunderstood the art of simile. You have confused being like something with being the same as something, with actually being the thing that it is.
Ah, oh, yes, I have, yeah. Anyway, I've decided, you know, I'm 26, and it's about time I had a serious relationship partner. Not just all this string of stupid gnats I've been fooling around with. So I thought I'd try one of these computer dating agencies, you know, that promised to find you your ideal partner. So earlier this week, I went to the Computo Dato Olinko Dato in Princes Street here in Edinburgh to see if they could help.
Richard, now let me just check your details. You've listed your interests as football, mm-hmm. fruit machines, yep. video games, Monty Python sketches, iced tea, drinking beer, and women's wrestling.
That's correct, yes. Those are all of my interests.
Well, we've fed that data into the computer, and I'm pleased to be able to say that your ideal partner is waiting for you now behind this sliding door.
Good.
Here's your perfect partner, Richard, Alan Stevens.
Hello.
Hello. But Alan is a man.
Yeah, the thing is, Richard, there aren't any women who have similar interests to you, nor indeed to any men at all. I've been in the computer dating business for 11 years now, and I think it's best just to put people of the same sex together. They have more in common. And Alan Stevens here does like all the same things as you.
I sure do.
Look, no offence, Alan. It's just I was, you know, hoping for a woman.
Yeah, well, so was I.
See? There's another thing you have in common.
Rich, do you want to go to the Fringe Club and play on the amusements tonight?
Well, you know...
There's nothing funny about it.
Well, all right. Be my lover now. Be my lover now. Wow, this Terminator 2 pinball machine's great, isn't it?
Yeah, it's my favourite too. I particularly like the payback time feature.
Yeah, me too, yeah. This is ace. I could never bring a girl here. Hey, Alan, hey, listen. This parrot, what I have got ya, is dead.
No, it isn't. It's alive. It's brilliant. That's the best sketch ever. Yeah. Do you want to load more beer?
Oh, yeah. Oh, you're great, Alan. Bitch ain't one. Terrific! I'm glad you like iced tea. I played this to the last girl I met and she slapped me in the face.
Iced tea really speaks to me, Rich. I come from Tring in Hertfordshire. There's an undercurrent of urban unrest there too.
Well, that was a terrific night out, Alan. Thanks very much.
Yeah. It was good when I won 20p on the quiz machine, wasn't it?
Yeah. I haven't had so much fun in ages. Well, I'd like to shake you by the hand and bid you goodbye.
Do you want to come in for a coffee? Go on.
All right then.
So, Rich, what happened next, then?
That is between me and Alan, Stuart.
Oh, yeah.
There's nothing funny about it, Stuart. If all men live with men and all women live with women, I think we'd have a much better society.
Well, only if I can watch, Rich.
That was fun.
Fun.
It's really good fun.
Best of fun.
Real world, real world, real, real world.
Yeah, now, Fist of Fun may appear to be nothing more than a lightweight, throwaway comedy show full of innuendo and puerile jokes, but... it has a hidden agenda, and that is to effect a real change in the real world around us.
Sure, if it's a hidden agenda, haven't you spoiled it by telling everyone that it's there?
Well, that's the thing about hidden agendas, Sir Rich. They have to be partly visible, otherwise there's no point in having them. Don't you even know that yet?
Right. I always think an agenda's more sexy if it's slightly hidden anyway, you know. Perhaps partially covered by a piece of silk.
No, Rich, you're confusing an agenda... with Julia Suwala from Press Gang, aren't you?
Yes, I am, yeah. Sorry.
Anyway, this week, is Radio 1 really the youth-friendly station it pretends to be?
In June this year, this advert here appeared in the Guardian newspaper.
Applications are invited for the post of controller of Radio 1. Applicants must have a broad knowledge of the music business and a direct understanding of the 16 to 35-year-old audience. The remuneration package for this appointment will be negotiable. Applications to Chris Story, room 4091, Broadcasting House.
Well, I read in Piers Morgan's excellently researched page in The Sun... that both Steve Wright and Simon Bates were applying for this job. So we thought, well, we're on Radio 1 as well now, aren't we? So if they're in with a shot, so are we. And so we both sent off these letters of application to Chris Story. Here they are, Stuart.
Right, this is my application. Dear Chris, I am writing to you to apply for the post of controller of Radio 1. My favourite bands at the moment are Sugar, The Spin Doctors, Chimney Factory and Bivouac. Obviously, as controller of Radio 1, I would play mainly them. But also other stuff, if people wrote in with requests. I feel I have a direct understanding of the 16 to 35 age group, as I am 25 years old, which is exactly half between 16 and 35. I look forward to the interview. Yours sincerely, Stuart Lee.
That is so rubbish, Stu. You haven't even enclosed a CV or anything. This is more like what they're looking for, my one. Look, dear Chris, I am applying for the post of controller of Radio 1 as advertised in the Guardian newspaper, which I read. Although I have no direct experience of controlling a radio station, I am quite good at controlling a radio. Changing the volume, tuning it in, changing over to the tape recording facility, etc. What I would do if I was in control is stop playing all the pop music, because you can't hear the lyrics and it's just bang, bang, bang anyway. I'm not interested in the remuneration package you mentioned. Would it be possible to receive a sort of weekly wage instead? About £200 a week would be fair, I think. See, I was chancing my arm a bit with that one there. Yours sincerely, Richard Herring. Well, I know what you're all thinking. Did either of us get the job?
Well, no, we didn't, obviously.
But I think I came close. Here's my reply, signed personally, look, by Mr. P.P. Chris Story himself. Dear Mr. Herring, Mr. mind you, I'm writing to say with regret that after very careful consideration of your application, it's been decided not to invite you to an interview board for the post of controller Radio 1. Thank you very much, nonetheless, for your interest and the trouble taken in the preparation of your application, you see. Yours sincerely, P.P. Chris Story.
Yes, Rich, but I got exactly the same rejection letter as you, look.
What? But I put about twice as much preparation as you did.
I know, that's where the standard letter system falls down, isn't it?
A Radio 1 show.
Never mind, Stu. Remember the fable of the tortoise and the hare?
Yes, I do remember that fable, Rich, but I don't see what that's got to do with you. The hare and the tortoise is an animal fable, and the problem with animal fables is that they are about animals. It's all very well to know that a tortoise may be faster than a hare in exceptional circumstances, but can you imagine any situation at all in which that information could be of the slightest use to anyone? No. So it's time for me to redress the balance.
Stuart Lee's True Fables.
This week, the tortoise and the man. Once upon a time, when the world was young, there lived a tortoise. And a man.
Hello.
Now, the man was jealous of the contented tortoise.
Hey, you, tortoise. I'm much better than you, you know. Yeah, and I'm going to prove it by racing you up to that old gnarled oak tree, eh? That'll settle it, and then we'll say no more about it, all right?
But the tortoise remained serene, for he was wise and noble, and because he was a tortoise and thus did not understand English. All too soon, the exciting day came. The man ran off as fast as his legs would carry him. But the tortoise didn't move a jot. Being only a reptile, it had little or no concept of competitive sports. 3 hours later, and the man was in sight of the end of the race.
Yeah, miles ahead, me. I'll just stop here for a breather.
Hey, up, look, lads, it's the man!
Hello, mate. Hi, Ian, Graham. Part of Forex, Graham, you know, if you're getting them in, yeah? Right. But just the one, I'm involved in a running race with a tortoise.
Oh, a tortoise, eh? You'll win easily, won't you? The tortoise is a notoriously slow creature.
Yeah, that's what I thought, yeah. So, it's time for another swift one, Mike, while you're up.
4 hours later.
All right, who wants another? Right, smile around, I'll get these. Oh, gee, look at the time. I've got to go. It's a race with tortoise. I've got to finish that race.
Every time it gets to his round, same bloody excuse.
Outside, the man looked up the road to the end of the race. And there, crossing the finishing line, what did he see? Nothing. As I've explained before, the tortoise had failed to grasp that the race or even the man existed at all. Were you listening to what I was saying, or am I just wasting my time here?
Anyway, stumbling drunkenly up the hill, the man crossed the finish line and fell into a heap.
Yes! I've won! I've beat the tortoise! I'm the best!
The tale of the tortoise and the man there. And remember, the moral of this story is, if a man were to race against a tortoise, a man would win. And if you don't have time to organise a sort of race against a tortoise, remember, if you turn them over on their back, they will just die.
Done.
Well, it's time for our second natural break. What have you been cooking up for us this time then, Pete?
Oh, some interesting ideas, I hope.
I hope so as well.
Now, in this bit, I've got some recipes and ideas for entertaining. If you've got a guest coming round, say, your brother Charlie, and you don't know what to give him and you haven't got much time, well, on the way home, why not pick up some chips? Now, my other idea for entertaining is for when you've got home, you've both eaten your chips and so you've run out of things to do. Well, one idea is put the telly on. Right, now, if you aren't having a guest because, I don't know, Charlie's tired, here are some ideas I've had of other things you can do for entertainment on your own. Number one, if you pass a bus stop which has a line of little hinge seats, then you can tap each of them into a horizontal position as you go past. Number two, buy a newspaper from the newsagent, then go to the library and sit in the reading room fairly near to the newspaper rack. Read an atlas until somebody comes up and asks for your newspaper. Then say, actually, it's my own newspaper. Number three, do an impression of Charlie in the mirror. And, of course, finally, if you feel like pampering yourself, why not round off the day with a glass of quick budget champagne, which is two Alka-Seltzers dropped into a glass of Liebfraumilch.
Thought for the week. Every year, performers, critics and audience members alike flock from London to Edinburgh for the Fringe Festival. Wouldn't it be simpler and cheaper all round if the Edinburgh Festival took place in London? The unique Edinburgh atmosphere could be recreated by employing a drunk Scottish man to run around Chelsea telling everyone to piss off back to London, you Sassenach bastards.
Well, the show's nearly over, and it's time for you and I to get into our big comedy bed and go to sleep until next week's show. Come on.
Oh, no, I'm not getting into bed with you.
Come on, there's nothing funny about it. Comedy partners have been getting into bed with one another at the end of their shows for centuries. Come on, Alistair. Alistair McGowan, ladies and gentlemen. In you get, Alistair.
Cheers. Now, Alistair, you're probably best known for your role as the caretaker in the recycling episode of BBC School's TV programme Think About Science, aren't you?
Think about finding out, think about science.
No, I think I'm probably best known for my impressions in Spitting Image, really.
Oh, no, Alistair. You're doing yourself down, mate. That caretaker was brilliant. It was... Think about finding out.
Do you want to hear my Chris Eubank?
I'm not a boxer.
No, leave that. No. Also in this week's show, let's snuggle up into bed with us, please, Rebecca Front, and jump into bed, Pete Bainham.
Pete, come on in, mate. Oh, would you like some of this?
What's that, then?
That's the trifle from my mouth.
All right, off to sleep now, comedy actors.
Goodbye.
Herring's Fist of Fun.